So should British Leyland be divided up? Geoffrey Robinson, the Labour MP for Coventry North West, is a former managing director of Jaguar Cars. Quinton Hazel built up the country's best-known spare part business for Leyland Cars. And they're both with Adam Raphael of The Observer.
Geoffrey Robinson, as a former senior executive of British Leyland, can I turn to you first? Leyland's in such a serious cash crisis, it's had to ask the government for £50 million, which was earmarked for investment, solely to pay the wages bill. Well, now, what is the solution? Should it be split up, this company?
Well, I don't think there's any immediate solution. Let's face the fact that we have in Leyland, particularly in the car division, a company that's of vital national importance to the economy. And to get that right is going to take some time. Not only are we a long way behind our competitors, we're also shooting at a moving target. We've got to catch up with them, and they're moving ahead the whole time. So I think if we imagine that there's an easy, quick solution, we're going to get it wrong from the start. And indeed, I would begin there and say that we've got to get rid of the illusion that the government can really close down a significant part of Leyland Cars' activities, which is the major troublemaker. Let's start there. The costs in social terms, in terms of balance of payments, in terms of increased unemployment benefits, stagger all belief. It's far, far more expensive to try and close it down in that way than to keep it going.
Could you let it stagger on as it is now, though?
No, we've got to get it right. But let's get the debate onto that area. What we need to do to get the company right. And the first thing we need to do is to stop saying we're going to close it down. Because I've just come back from Europe. I've been seeing a lot of old friends in the distribution over in Europe. The question they always ask me is, but is the government going to close it down? Is Leyland going to go on? Now, how are you going to sell cars to customers in an extremely competitive international market if that's the question mark hanging over the company?
So what would you do?
Let's get rid of that. That's the first thing to get rid of. And say we're going to do what the French did with Renault, and let's back British Leyland. That's the first thing. The next thing, then, is we've got to undo the rider folly. I mean, he had a magnificent opportunity back in 75 to restructure the company the way it should have been done.
The chairman of NEB who put forward the plan.
Yes, I mean, the whole thing was a nonsense. I said that so at the time, and regrettably now I've been proved right. There's no pleasure in that. It's very sad to have to say it. We must now go back to first principles. We have to recognise, and this is the second illusion we have to rid ourselves of, that Leyland is not a coherent entity in any meaningful sense, that there are within it some strong divisions and some weaker ones. They must be split into their respective discrete divisions. And I would say there were four: the special products, the truck and bus, which incidentally I think the introductory remarks tonight probably exaggerated the strength of. And then there are specialist cars, which should be separate from volume cars. And if we did that, I think we'd be going a long way down the road to getting to grips with the real problems at Leyland.
Quinton Hazel, can I bring you in here? If you were in sole charge of British Leyland, without the government or the NEB on your back, what would you do?
Well, I didn't know I was going to agree what Geoffrey Robinson said, and probably we'd do it in a different manner. But I think that the first and foremost thing is to stop talking about closing it down. After all, I too was in Europe, only got back on Sunday, and this fear of closure is a very serious thing, and there are so many people involved. It just cannot be talked about. But I think that we must do this split-up. I think the rider set-up was a complete nonsense and has seen to be such. First of all, we've got to get every man to go to work every day because we just need the production. Otherwise, we're going to see the disaster that's on at the present moment where foreign cars are taking over 50% of the market. Secondly, we have got to talk about a British motor industry, and I would like to see it split up and the major components go back onto the stock exchange with a quotation.
How far would you push the split up? I mean, for instance, would you split the car divisions into specialist cars, into mass volume cars, into powertrain, engineering, component parts, or would you leave it just at the car division as one entity, the specialist products as another entity? How far would you push?
Yes, I think that Geoff Robinson has this dead right. I think into four divisions. The only one I wouldn't like to run is the final solid mass that's left at Longbridge and Cowley. But the others, I think, are a marvellous challenge. And there's no doubt about it that we have lost identity.
And not replaced it with another one. We've destroyed all the old identities, wouldn't you agree? Things that people believed in, things they associated themselves with, and we failed to replace it with anything better. And this is another lesson we've got to learn from the situation. But I'd like to take Quinton Hazel up, if I may, on his statement he'd give it back to the private sector. I really believe that we would do far better for the foreseeable future, and this is quite apart from any doctrinaire ideological views about which we might differ, to stick with public ownership, because the scale of investment required in trucks and buses, which are getting near the situation that Austin Morris was 10 years ago, under no illusion about that, and the scale of investment even required for a profitable specialist car division, and even two, for the special products division, are such that they can best and most securely, for the foreseeable future, be supplied from the public person. We should be confident enough about our ability to deal with these industrial relations and problems that we have, these industrial structural problems that we have, to do it. Because if we can't get Leyland right, heaven knows it's the acid test of our will to get anything right. And if we don't do that, we'll end up exporting people instead of motor cars.
But what for the future? I mean, what I don't understand with Clinton Hazel's idea of selling it back to the private sector, is there anyone in the private sector who would take on the mass volume car division at the moment, producing Allegros, Marinas, and perhaps the new Mini?
I would think that that would be the most difficult situation to settle. But why should we destroy the marvellous name of Jaguar, the wonderful name of Rover, the name of Triumph, because somebody can't get the other side right? It strikes me at the present moment that none of the divisions are producing the cars that are necessary.
Well, let me ask Geoffrey Robinson here, how do you demonstrate to the people who are working in Leyland, the people on the shop floor, that their future depends on their actions and their efforts, not on the decisions of ministers?
Well, they know that. They want it to succeed. And I think the idea that we seem to be bandying about, that if only the only way to get them to respond is to threaten them, is ill-conceived. I think it's psychologically counterproductive, and I think from a practical point of view, it's unrealizable. And I think that the men, they won't understand a veiled threat, less still will they accept a hollow threat. But they will. They're refractory car workers. They're the British people. They will respond to a challenge. And if we could again change the debate from this threat of closure to the challenge of doing as well as the French did with Renault, or the Germans did, you'd find you get a totally different response.
Well, how important, then, is this new graded wages system with centralised bargaining that Leyland are trying to introduce?
It's very important. It's very desirable. I certainly hope they'll vote for it, let that be said. But it's no more a panacea than any of the other nostrums peddled by Ryder and the committee. And the simple fact is that Leyland, we need manageable units, coherent units, effective, competent management with integrity, and above all, some leadership. And all that could come if I think they adopted the proposals that Quinton Hazel and myself have been putting forward.
Quinton Hazel.
I'd just like to say that, you know, if anybody really thought what the Midlands would be like with 400,000 people unemployed, with a lack of police control, this is not on. Mm. And therefore, the British people have got to realise that we've got to put this motor industry right.
Exactly.
It is vitally important. And anything else is waffle. We've got to talk of success and being successful. And
well, let me ask you, Quinton Hazel, is it right that £50 million in taxpayers' money, which was voted by Parliament for investment, should be now being used to pay the wages bill?
At the present moment, there is no alternative, because this is the way the Ryder report decreed that the thing should be run. I think Geoffrey Robinson and I have said that it must be changed in the way it is run. But don't get any illusion that you can all throw it into a box and finish with it. This is not possible at the present moment.
Isn't reorganisation, though, Geoffrey Robinson, and this is really the crunch question, isn't it really a euphemism or another way of saying there's going to have to be large-scale redundancies, in particularly
no,
in the mass
not.
Scale?
No, absolutely not.
Mass
absolutely not, because I think the point that Quinton Hazel has just made, and it comes well, I think, indeed, from a private sector industrialist, a self-made man, an entrepreneur, who realises that the social repercussions of any such steps would be totally unacceptable, are so self-evident that no government is going to do it, no Tory government's going to do it, no Labour government's going to do it, and it's wrong to continually emphasise that aspect, which is the wrong aspect of the problem. What reorganisation would do for you is to bring you at much closer grips with the real problems and give you the opportunity of bringing it in onto a basis where government support would be more effectively and profitably used.
But you say the Ryder plan's in a mess. But should we go ahead now with the rest of the £1,400 million investment programme,
Well, he got it all wrong in that respect too. Leyland Cars never had the ability, in terms of engineering resources, manufacturing engineering and product engineering resources, to spend the money that Ryder thought was necessary. That was all wrong. On the other hand, he did underestimate, because of the losses they've made, the drive, in my opinion, very largely from the decisions that he took, their working capital requirements. Now, if you can't be flexible between the two, which any normal company is, I'm quite sure my colleague would agree with that tonight, then you're already inhibiting yourself in a totally unbusinesslike manner to deal with businesslike problems. You've got to realise there's a certain amount of money needed, which will be more for working capital and less for capital investment.
Hill, can I get you back to perhaps a sort of a thing which everyone can? Jaguar was a great name in the British car industry. You've known the company over 40 years. You know Bill Lyons very well, the founder of the company. What's gone wrong with that part of British Leyland?
Well, you see, may I just take you into Birmingham? May I give you three football teams? West Bromwich, the Villa, and Birmingham. Nobody who supports West Bromwich wants to go and see Birmingham unless they're paying West Bromwich, and so on and so forth. And so the people identify themselves with a company. In Jaguar, with Sir William Lyons and later on with Geoffrey Robinson, people had an identity. They didn't call it a BLMC division. They called it the Jaguar, the Triumph.
Exactly.
People want to be...
They still refer to them as such.
Absolutely.
They still
but this has been destroyed. So you've got to build back this image and this belief
and
in what they're making.
And as a supplier, it was much better when we were there.
Thank you very much.
I would agree.
Thank you very much indeed, Fahmy.
Pleasure.